Tonight on KQED Newsroom, how a small city in Orange County has kicked off a wave of resistance to the state's sanctuary policies. We'll talk with the mayor. And the former head of the Sierra Club, Carl Pope, lays out a vision for how every person, city, and business can fight climate change. Plus, political analysis of this week's top stories, including Governor Brown's decision to deploy National Guard troops at the border. Hello and welcome to KQED Newsroom. I'm Thuy Vu. We begin with immigration battles. This week, the City of Los Alamitos in Orange County declared itself exempt from a statewide law that's been generating national debate and drawing criticism from President Trump. That law, SB 54, also known as the California Values Act, prohibits state and local police agencies from helping federal authorities with immigration enforcement in many cases. Since the Los Alamitos action, a wave of other cities in Orange County, as well as the county's Board of Supervisors, have also voiced opposition to SB 54. They have voted to join the Trump administration in suing California over laws aimed at protecting undocumented immigrants. And joining me now via Skype to discuss all of this is Los Alamitos Mayor Troy Edgar. Mr. Edgar, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Thanks for having me on.
Well, the vote was 4-1 in favor of exempting Los Alamitos from the state sanctuary laws. You voted in support. Why?
Well, for me personally, it was a constitutional issue. As a U.S. Navy veteran and city council member, mayor of a city for over 12 years, you know, I took an oath of office to support and defend the U.S. Constitution. And for me, I just really felt that this law, basically, I could not comply with. And I had a like-minded city council member. Then we put it on the agenda, and we ended up voting 4-1 to basically exempt ourselves from SB 54.
Your wife is an immigrant from Iran, so what is your personal stand on immigration policy?
You know, for me, I think a little bit of the misnomer on this issue is it's absolutely not about immigration. You know, my wife being from Iran, basically at 18, the Shah was overthrown. She's a Christian. She was living over there as a minority. And really, her family lost all their property. She ended up getting in prison, going to Paris, and then waiting for 2 years to get into the United States. You know, and you'll find that in a lot of the Persian community and the Assyrian community is a lot of folks that went that way. I also have a lot of Hispanic friends, same type of thing. They waited their turn. So from my perspective, you know, when I say I love immigrants, I absolutely mean it. But, you know, it's because my wife is an immigrant. And if you look at our city council, probably 4/5 of our council are either married to immigrants or immigrants themselves. So, again, this has nothing to do with immigrants and our dislike of immigrants. This has to do with basically criminals that are illegally in this country and whether our city should be working with the ICE authorities or the federal government to be able to take care of this issue.
Well, according to the Los Alamitos police chief, there hasn't been a federal immigration raid in your city in more than 10 years. How many undocumented immigrants are there in Los Alamitos?
Yeah, you know what? I'm not too sure what what sort of account of the illegal or undocumented workers there are in the city. But, you know, this goes back to a bigger picture. Our city is one of the safest cities in Orange County. Half of our budget goes towards police. We're known for being very proactive and making sure that we make the right decisions to have the highest the best response time for police, the lowest crime rate. So being proactive, you know, when we go through this process, you know, we just want to make sure as policymakers to our city, whether it's the police chief or anybody in his organization, is from the top of our city, we want our folks working with U.S. federal officials when it comes to immigration. We don't know why there would be any other reason why the state would compel us to do otherwise.
The American Civil Liberties Union and several other immigrant rights groups are basically suing, and they're asking the courts to declare what you did, the new ordinance, illegal. Your reaction to that?
Well, obviously, from being able to comment specifically on the case, I can't because it's pending the litigation. But, you know, the reality is the ACLU from the very beginning has been trying to bully us through this process. They've sent two demand letters in, one before the first vote in March 19th, the second one for the April 16th vote, just threatening us. And, you know, from my perspective, you know what, I'm representing the people in my community. Half of our base is a military, or half of our city is a military base. And, you know, being a council member for 12 years, I feel I fairly represent our community and what, you know, the types of actions that we should be taking. So I'm unfazed by the ACLU lawsuit. And, you know, I think over time, you know, we'll end up having to engage that in more when we find out more about it.
Mayor Edgar, how do you feel about concerns from immigrant communities that this could make Los Alamitos less safe by making undocumented immigrants more reluctant to come forward and report crimes if they're fearing deportation?
Well, first of all, I think if you've talked to the police chief, you'll know that that really is not the case. There would be situations of unintended consequences. You know, if somebody is out as a criminal and they're undocumented and they actually do get released out into the community, and, you know, one of the biggest issues is those people go back to the community where they victimized people in the past. If those people are people that are actually undocumented and the situation goes down around them, that is a chance that something like that could happen. But I think for the most part, this is not about trying to put a fear factor in people that are here that are undocumented. Something that I say is, you know, I tell people the example is, look, if you have a party at your house and you invite people and some people come that are uninvited and they start doing bad stuff, you don't want them there, they need to go. And that really, I think really what we're trying to do is, you know, this is something that is a local issue. It's about local control for us. And it really is a U.S. constitutional issue, which is that we should not have to make a choice between directing our police, whether they have to work with U.S. Custom officials or whether immigration officials or whether they're going to work with the state.
And just real quickly, we have about 20 seconds remaining. Have you gotten calls from other California cities now interested in doing the same thing that Los Alamitos has done?
Absolutely. Since we had done the first vote, we sent off over 500 letters to mayors and city council members of every city of California. I spend 2 to 3 hours a day talking with mayors and city council members interested in moving this forward in their city. And I also get a lot of calls from active citizens and folks in the communities that want to try to figure out how to work with their city council to get this item on the agenda. So you'd be really surprised of a lot of the cities up in Northern California that are very interested in being a part of this.
All right, Mayor Troy Edgar of Los Alamitos, we thank you for your time.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Staying with politics, this week, Governor Jerry Brown announced that up to 400 National Guard troops will be sent to the U.S.-Mexico border. The governor says the troops will fight criminal gangs, human traffickers, and drug and gun smugglers. They will not, however, help with immigration enforcement or building a new border wall. The announcement sparked criticism from President Trump. In a tweet, he called the deployment, quote, a charade. Joining me now to talk about all of this and other political developments are Dr. Rafael Sonnenschein, executive director of the Pat Brown Institute, who joins us via Skype from Cal State Los Angeles, Republican political consultant Sean Walsh, and San Francisco Chronicle senior political writer Jill Garofoli. Welcome to you all. And Dr. Sonnenschein, let me begin with you. We just got done talking to the mayor of Los Alamitos. It certainly isn't the only city to be rebelling against California sanctuary laws. We've seen other Orange County cities do that. We've seen Orange County itself and San Diego County have voted to join the federal lawsuit against the laws. Where do you see all of this going from here?
It may not go much farther than here, because Orange County, especially in the south, and San Diego County are probably the hotbed of resistance to the state sanctuary law. I do think it's a very big issue there, and it's a mobilizing issue for Republicans that could affect House races and turnout. It's attracted the attention of President Trump. I think you'll see some other cities around the state, some counties, but I think this is the most significant area where this is going on, especially because this is where the big House races are in November that could decide control of the House of Representatives.
And Joe, do you agree with that? Because, for example, Kristen Gaspar, who is a San Diego supervisor who voted for this, some have accused her of exploiting the sanctuary law controversy to help boost her profile in her race for Daryl Issa's seat in San Diego County.
Right. This issue gives the Republicans some voice. They've sort of found their voice in this. We call it the resistance to the resistance. I believe I came up with that term. Yes.
Well, that was
taking
where I first read
claiming
it
credit
article.
For that right here on KQED. But what it does is it allows folks, the Republicans, to sort of embrace Trump's agenda without embracing Trump. Trump in California is toxic. They don't want to do this. But this is one of Trump's core issues. This is something that appeals to sort of the law and order suburban crowd, which is the Orange County districts are largely that. And and also, it allows Republicans to sort of gin up and get out the vote because they need help. They're not going to have a Senate candidate, and they may not have a candidate on the ballot for governor.
Sean, you're raising your eyebrows.
Oh, I am.
Joe
I mean,
speaking.
Time after time, Nancy Pelosi and some of the activists in the Democratic Party run into walls with regards to they think that their values and their approach is what the rest of the country shares. And I think the Haas study, almost 2,500 people demonstrate, it's not just San Diego, it's not just Orange County, it's not just Los Alamitos, but all over the state, people have very serious concerns about illegal immigration. And so it is an issue not just for Republicans, but it's also an issue for Democrats and conservatives.
And that's the study that you just referred to, the Haas study by UC Berkeley, found that nearly half of the people surveyed support President Trump's travel ban and more deportation of undocumented immigrants. But I know, Dr. Sonnenschein, that you have some concerns about how that study was conducted.
Oh, it's a good study. I guess my concerns are how it's portrayed. I actually made some calls to look at some of the data. I don't think this study shows quite what Sean is saying. I think it shows overwhelming support for more of a progressive position on immigration, and then in some ambiguously worded questions about things like the Muslim ban and deportation, which have gotten highlighted in the news coverage. One of them asked, how important is the goal of deporting undocumented residents? And that got some support. Then the next question was, what about a path to citizenship? And it gets over 70% support. It's kind of hard to deport people and get them into citizenship at the same time. I think it's actually a good survey, but I think it's getting a little overestimated. Even though I do think Sean's right, there is a base of opposition on the Democratic position on immigration. I don't think it's coming from Democrats, though. I think it's coming more from Republicans.
Well, I just disagree. I mean, you're showing 50% of people in the Bay Area actually have these positions. I think there is the old saying of there's a right way to come to the country and a wrong way. The country, and particularly California, embraces legal immigration and legal immigrants. But they have a problem with people who have come here illegally. And they have a soft spot in their heart for DACA kids, and that's completely understandable. But, you know, when you see Mayor Libby Schaaf, who says we are going to alert people when they're trying to deport criminals from Oakland and other parts of California, it makes people angry. They think that's a wrong-headed approach from a government perspective. So it doesn't surprise me at all that this actual survey, which is a large number of people, you see the cleaving between legal immigration and right versus wrong.
The talking to Republican pollsters in Southern California who are tapped into these races, the intensity for this issue is off the charts for Republicans and to nonpartisan swing voters in the suburbs. This appeals to them. If you cast it, if the Republicans can cast it as supporting law enforcement, because that's what people in the suburbs can relate to on this issue. They may not relate to an immigration issue, but if they are relating this to, I'm supporting my local law enforcement officer, then the Republicans might have some traction. Because the gas tax, you know, the Republicans had envisioned that as something to get their voters to come out. It's not as that doesn't have the intensity, the emotional connection as this issue does.
And what about from a legal standpoint? You talked about the emotional connection just now, Joe, but Dr. Sonnenschein, is this a case of the state overreaching, going back to the sanctuary laws? Is it a case of overreach by the state?
Well, I didn't go to law school, so I try to lay off those. I'm a political scientist. Just speaking politically, I think that the state sanctuary law, while it was a very carefully designed law, it was certainly in a political realm, opened the door for local governments where Republicans are strong to become a resistance to a state law as opposed to just another community with a position on this. I completely agree with Joe, though, that this is the animating issue in the Republican Party. And it's the reason Trump became president. It's the reason he wiped out all of his opposition in the primaries, was his focus on immigration. Just as Democrats sometimes dream that everybody agrees with them, though, I don't think the general public has that same feeling about the immigration issue. So what helps gin up Republican turnout in these races will also gin up Democratic turnout. Given that, I don't think the Republicans have another issue. The tax cut has not turned out to be a magic bullet. As Joe said, the gas tax hasn't really gone anywhere. There's not enough Republican candidates statewide. This is it. This is the one key. And midterm elections, as all of our guests know, are not about persuasion. They're about motivation and mobilization.
And meanwhile, we have the deployment of the 400 National Guard troops. Governor Jerry Brown has said that he won't do it, but they won't be involved with, he will do it, but they won't be involved with immigration enforcement or wall construction. And his office is saying that the federal government has agreed to pay for this. The Trump administration taking some issue with that.
Yeah, they've gone back and forth on this. The Trump said, no, we're not going to do it. And then, the same day, I believe it was, the National Guard itself said, no, we aren't. We just got Pentagon funding to do this. So this is, we're talking about 400 troops. This is mostly both Brown and the president appealing to their bases. This is, we're talking about, these are not major movements of troops or anything like that. They're both kind of, it's a political thing. Just, and they're both appealing to their bases.
Just further poisoning the relationship, though, between California and Washington?
Well, I think the president's itching for a fight with California, and not just the fact that this is going to affect those four seats that are targeted by the Democrats in Southern California, but this has national salience. So this is an issue that really, as Rafe said earlier, President Trump in large part got elected based on his immigration stance. So I think this has, and as he said, you need motivation to get your voters out. I think there's still a strong motivation on the Democratic side for the, women's movement and the pink hat crowd. And so now you've got something that makes people equally as passionate to come out on the other side. And a lot of these races are decided by a couple hundred votes in many areas. So this could be a very, very important political motivator.
Can I jump in about Governor Brown for just a second? I hate to
absolutely, Rafe. Go ahead.
I give some credit to what Jerry Brown did here. It was rather clever. Every Democratic candidate for governor said absolutely no to the deployment of the National Guard. Republican governors said absolutely yes. And Jerry Brown, in his philosophical way, found a way to put President Trump in a really bad spot. He said, maybe, let's look at it. And then he said, since I'm the commander of the National Guard, unless you federalize it, they're going to do what I want to do. It was a reasonable proposal. The Defense Department supported it. And as the president tends to do, he goes to his base and overturns yet another cabinet secretary. Previously it was Nikki Haley on Russia sanctions, leaving them out there hanging. But what Brown did was not for his base. His base wanted him to say a flat no. And I don't know any other Democrat who can take that kind of position with the credibility that Jerry Brown can get away with.
And meanwhile, making a speech this week that said the immigration debate has become an inflammatory football that very low-life politicians like to exploit. Jerry Brown gets away with saying stuff like that. But I want to move off immigration for a moment and also ask about this other item that just happened today. The Democratic National Committee has just filed a multi-million dollar lawsuit against Russia, the Trump campaign, and also WikiLeaks, alleging that there's a conspiracy to disrupt the 2016 presidential election. Sean, what do you make of this? Can Russia, for example, be sued? Don't they have immunity? Other nations have immunity from most U.S. lawsuits?
Well, we might as well sue Assad in Syria for all the effect that will do. This is pure politics, nothing more and nothing less. I think there is some concern that Mueller could wrap up his investigation early, and having this litigation going forward potentially could keep this issue alive into the primaries and then into the November election. Speaking of lawsuits, I mean, there's better standing for Bernie Sanders to sue the Democratic National Committee for colluding with the Democrat or Hillary Clinton's campaign to get him wiped out as a president. So it's all politics, and it doesn't have any standing in court.
And the Democrats should be careful. Don't pin your hopes on being anti-Trump. You have to have a message along with being anti-Trump. The people who are anti-Trump are already there with you. You have to get something else to get their voters to come out, because traditionally their voters have not come out in midterm elections, particularly Latino voters. So they need to do something positive to get their voters out, or else, you're not going to do it on bashing Trump. That group's already with you.
All right. On that note, we're going to have to end it here. I want to thank all of you. Thanks to Rafe Sonnenshine with the Pat Brown Institute of Public Affairs at Cal State LA. Thanks so much for being with us.
Pleasure.
And also, of course, Sean Walsh, Republican strategist, and also San Francisco Chronicle senior political writer Joe Garofoli. Always good to see you, gentlemen.
Thank you. Great to be here.
Turning now to climate change, with Earth Day coming up this weekend, we talked to the former head of the Sierra Club, Carl Pope. His new book is titled Climate of Hope. He co-authored it with former New York City Mayor Michael Bloomberg. In the book, Pope lays out a vision for how individuals, businesses, and local governments can battle climate change, even when state and national governments won't. And Carl Pope joins me now in the studio. Nice to have you here.
Great to be here again.
Well, in your book, you say that it's time for a new type of conversation about climate change. What do you think is wrong with the way it's being discussed now, and how would you like to reframe the conversation?
Well, we have talked about climate change as this enormous problem which requires phenomenal sacrifice, and the conversation is who's going to pay the bill. That used to be true. It's not true anymore. Right now, climate change is an enormous economic opportunity, and the question is, who's going to take the lead? That's a different kind of conversation.
And you also point out that a lot of it has talked about very long-term consequences, not something that people can relate to now, talking about how to make money, not sacrifices, and focusing on polar bears, not asthmatic children.
That's exactly right. And if you look, for example, the conversation we're having, people don't realize that many of the states which have done the most to reduce their carbon footprint are states like Oklahoma and Texas, which did it not because they had governors who cared about climate change, they didn't, but because they had utility customers who wanted cheaper power, and wind is cheaper than coal.
And so there was a money-making incentive there.
And it was immediate. The utility rates in Texas have been coming down. Wholesale power rates in Texas have been coming down significantly because we're retiring coal and replacing it with natural gas, wind, and solar.
And, you know, much of the debate over climate change centers around doom and gloom scenarios. And you point out in the book that those scaring tactics don't really work with people. Why not?
Well, because, frankly, if you're trying to get somebody, if you're a rock climbing coach, and you're trying to get somebody to do a pitch that is harder than something they've done before, you don't get them to do it by saying, oh, my God, this is going to be hard. I'm not sure you can do this. I just don't know. No, you've got to say to the person you're coaching, you say, hey, this is like something you've done before, and I know you can do it, and you're going to have to stretch, you're going to have to work, you're going to have to be on. And that's what we need to tell people about climate change, not this is this catastrophic, awful thing that I don't think we can do it, and oh, my God, the numbers are so bad. You say, wait a minute. We got rid of a class of refrigeration chemicals that were destroying the ozone layer. Now we have a class of refrigeration chemicals that are destroying the climate. But we know how to replace them with better stuff. We replaced the first set, we can replace this set. So we need to make it familiar and comfortable for people.
So let's expand on that, because you also write in the book that the major contributors to global warming are buildings, right? That is the electricity we use in our homes, our offices, also transportation, and the stuff we make, steel, toys, furniture. And so there are so many complex layers here. So what can I, as an individual, do? What are the top two things I can do to help fight climate change?
Well, it depends on who you are, because everybody has a different set of institutional connections. Everybody is in part of, people are part of families, they're part of communities, they vote for school boards, they work for companies, they may teach students. And in all of those roles, you have an opportunity to focus the conversation on how can we simultaneously make tomorrow better and do better today. And everybody has those opportunities. You just have to look around you and say, where do I have connection to other people, and how can I work with those other people to speed up the rate of progress towards better outcomes for the climate, which are also going to be better outcomes for making us wealthier and healthier.
So, and we have a couple of things going on right now, right? We have this American Lung Association report that just came out this week that says out of the top 10 U.S. cities with the most ozone pollution, 8 of them are in California, including Los Angeles, Sacramento, and Fresno. And at the same time, we have a federal government that is rolling back quite a few provisions of the Clean Air Act. And so what effect do you see the Trump administration having on federal policies regarding climate change?
Well, the Trump administration is making federal policies horrible. It turns out that doesn't have to matter that much. For example, let's talk about air pollution in California. I've been working on this problem for 40 years. For 40 years, California has been trying to clean up the internal combustion engine. And we've done really a remarkable job. And for most of those 40 years, Washington was resisting. So most of the progress California made in cleaning up the car, which is now translated into national progress, was made by California without Washington. We now recognize we can't do the job with gas powered. We need to electrify vehicles, and that's how we're going to solve California's pollution problem. And California can take the lead and is taking the lead on getting that done, even though Donald Trump wants to pretend that electric cars aren't better than internal combustion cars. They are.
But surely there must be some impacts, right? I mean, how is the administration's policies, viewpoints on climate change, for example, affecting the way that environmentalists are doing their work?
Well, it's affecting what environmentalists do, but what really matters is it affecting the way American electricity consumers behave? Is it affecting the way American drivers behave? Is it affecting the way American manufacturers behave? Not so much. They all look at the Trump administration and say, he's going to be there for a while. He's going to be gone. We're investing in the future. Well, there was a survey done of all the public utilities when Trump announced, I'm going to bring back coal. And one of the consulting firms went out to all the electric utilities and said, well, is this changing what you're investing in? And only one company out of 42 said that it would change their investment strategy. The rest said, we're not investing for the next 3 years. Mm-hmm. We're investing for the next 20 years. And the next 20 years, we need wind and solar.
And just real quickly, I mean, I have to ask you about this. In terms of strategies, local governments in California, New York City, for example, even Colorado this week, are now taking the strategy of suing oil and gas companies over the cost of climate change. Good or bad strategy?
That's a good strategy, and that strategy has now been joined by a conservative libertarian think tank in Washington. So we're beginning to see people coming in from the other side and saying, well, if the government's not going to hold the oil industry accountable, individual citizens can.
All right, Carl Pope, thank you. Nice to have
Great.
You here.
Thanks to be with you.
And that will do it for us. You can find more of our coverage at kqed.org/newsroom. I'm Thuy Vu. Thank you for joining us.